Good evening, everyone, and welcome. My name is Sheila, and I'm the events planner for Kitchener Public Library. I'm pleased to welcome you to tonight's event. Before we begin the program, I would like to start with a land acknowledgement. As we gather, we are reminded that the library is situated on land that is the traditional home of the Haudenosaunee, Anishinaabe, and Neutral people. We recognize and deeply appreciate their historic connection to this place. We also recognize the contributions Indigenous peoples have made in shaping and strengthening this community. We are grateful for the opportunity to meet here and reaffirm our collective commitment to make the promise and the challenge of truth and reconciliation real in our community. Before I introduce tonight's guests, just some housekeeping details. There will be time for Q&A following the author discussion, and we will invite you to use the Q&A feature. We'll monitor the questions, and as time permits, they will be sent to our guests to answer. We wish to thank the City of Kitchener's Imagine It Fund for sponsoring this event. We also want to thank Simon & Schuster Canada and publicists Rita Silva and Jillian Lubbock for their support of our author events, both past live events and now virtual. With the weather turning warmer and now a year since we've moved online, we appreciate each of you, our audience, for making the time to participate and support our online events. Now to tonight's author event, and I'm happy to share that this is our 12th 85 Queen online event. And I'm thrilled to be welcoming Samantha and Marissa back to Kitchener Public Library tonight. Previously, we hosted both ladies for in-library book launches. And last spring, Marissa participated in a virtual creative writing workshop to a dedicated group of local writers. And just this past Tuesday night, I attended a book launch for Marissa's latest book, Lucky. I was an attendee for this one, and it was wonderful to see the support she received from her friends and family. It felt a bit like I was crashing an online family reunion of love and celebration for Marissa. And while I miss the in-person, personal part of events, including the snacks and the book signings and the photo ops, I'm thrilled to welcome both ladies back tonight. And I extend a warm Kitchener Public Library welcome to Laurie Flynn for her book launch with us tonight. And I look forward to tonight's discussion. At this time, I'd like to introduce our interviewer, Sam. Samantha Bailey is the USA Today and number one Toronto Star and Globe and Mail bestselling author of Woman on the Edge. Her psychological thriller debut received a starred reader from Publishers Weekly and was a PW Best Books Pick of the Week. It was also the December Fiction Book of the Month at Indigo Books and the Shoppers Drug Mart January Book Lovers Pick. Woman on the Edge is published in North America with Simon & Schuster Canada and in the UK with Headline. It will also be translated in 9 countries worldwide. Samantha is a journalist and freelance editor. Her work has appeared in Now Magazine, The Village Post, and Oxford University Press, among other publications. She lives in Toronto, and you can connect with her on Twitter at Sam S. Bailey Books and on her website at SamanthaMBailey.com. At this time, I invite Sam to the screen, and she will introduce and welcome tonight's authors and moderate the discussion and Q&A. Welcome, Samantha, and thanks for coming back to Kitchener.
Hi, Sheila. It is such a joy to be here. I wish we could be at the Kitchener Public Library in person. It is the most beautiful space. But I am so thrilled to be here with Marissa and Laurie, who are my Simon & Schuster Canada sisters, and they are my friends. And I loved these books so, so much. All right, I think we're going to start with Laurie Elizabeth Flynn.
All right. Hi, everyone.
Hi, Laurie. So I'm just going to tell everyone a little about you. And then I know that we would absolutely love to hear an excerpt from your book. So Laurie Elizabeth Flynn is a former model who lives in London, Ontario, with her husband and their 3 children, including a newborn. She is the author of 3 young adult novels, Firsts, Last Girl Lied To, and All Eyes on Her. Her adult fiction debut, The Girls Are All So Nice Here, was released in March and became an instant bestseller in Canada. It has sold in 11 territories worldwide and has been optioned for television by AMC. Hi, Laurie.
Hi, thank you so much for that introduction. It is amazing to be here, and I'm so happy to be able to talk more about this book and to be in such amazing company with Sam and Marissa. I feel very grateful, and I'm going to start with a little reading from The Girls Are Also Nice Here. So just to give a little bit of context, this is the introductory chapter to the past tense timeline, where the main character, Ambrosia, is a freshman in college, and she's just moving in for the first time. So I think a lot of us will be able to relate to some of the things she's feeling. All right. I would be spending freshman year in the Butterfields, living in a double room on the first floor. Butterfield C was shaped almost like a question mark, hugging a courtyard where I pictured myself sitting with a book, wind lifting my hair. I had emailed with my future roommate a few times, but we'd never actually met. Her parents were helping her break a mini fridge out of its cardboard jail when I first saw her, along with a younger girl who must have been her sister. I had just seen my own parents off. My mom would probably weep all the way back to Pennington, my dad placating her with promises that I'd be back. My older sister, Toni, had left for college at Rutgers 2 years before, but she was close enough that she still came home most weekends, bulging laundry bag in tow. "This is your time, sweetie," Mom had said before she closed the car door, her lips on my cheek. "Enjoy it, but stay out of trouble." As if trouble were labeled with a do not disturb sign, as if a sign would have kept me out. I wished my best friend Billy were with me, but Billy hadn't gotten into Wesleyan. She was spending the next 4 years at Miami University in Ohio, which was known more for partying than anything else. Our friendship was comfortable, a bond forged in our awkwardness when we started ninth grade and our shared willingness to do something about it. Billy knew who I was and who I wanted to be, and she loved both versions. I had already texted her since arriving on campus. "I hope people like me." Her buoyant "they will" brought some comfort. My new roommate's hair was white blonde and her dress was gingham, like something I had been forced to wear as a kid to the Memorial Day parade. She didn't look like the girls I had gone to high school with, all of us in the same uniform of mini skirts and Uggs, buttressing legs slathered in self-tanner. But she was exceptionally pretty, freshly scrubbed, wholesome. Billy probably would have given her a nickname. It was our meager defense against the mean girls at Hopewell Valley Central High. We studied them, then peeled them like overripe fruit in marathon gossip sessions to lessen the sting of not being invited to their parties. "My roomie is Heidi," I'd text Billy. Her real name was just as bad. "I guess you already know from our emails, but I'm Flora." She gripped me in a hug. "It's nice to finally meet in person. You look just how I pictured. These are my parents, and this is my sister, Poppy." Poppy gave me a shy wave, all bangs and big blue eyes. "Ambrosia," I said, more to them than to her. "Just call me Amb." Flora didn't look how I pictured. She was a lot prettier. I knew from our emails that she was involved with student council at her Connecticut private school. She didn't smoke or drink and wanted to become a child psychologist. She wore her niceness so openly. She was exactly the kind of friend my parents wanted me to make, what Billy would call a tryhard. "Am," Flora's mom said, fixing me with a frosty stare. "Where are you from?" "Pennington," I said, "New Jersey." "That's nice," she said, but I could tell by her pinched mouth that it wasn't, that I had already committed some kind of wrong. "You take care of Flora. She tends to trust everyone too easily." "Mom," Flora said, her cheeks turning petal pink, "stop." Flora's mom looked like she wanted to say more, but pressed her mouth into a line. I rolled her words around. I didn't know if I'd been folded into her confidence or warned not to be a person her daughter couldn't trust. "We're going to have such a fun year," Flora said when her family was gone. She had squeezed her sister the hardest, whispered something in her ear that I couldn't hear. My mom is actually still best friends with her roommate from freshman year. I felt a bloop of excitement. It was going to be a fun year. I had worked hard to get here, to make things happen, to chisel out a technicolor future, panoramic in scope, with me as its star. "Your accent is so cute," Flora said as she tacked photos to her corkboard. "Thanks," I managed, but I wasn't thankful. She didn't mean it as an insult, probably, but she had made me self-conscious about something I hadn't considered noticeable before. What I said was as important as how I said it. I couldn't be an actress. And I'd come to Wesleyan for the theater program if I couldn't escape Jersey. So that's just a little taste of what's to come.
It's so devious. Right from the opening. Oh, she has such a great voice. Thank you so much. I can't wait to talk about it more.
Thank you.
And now I'm going to bring Marissa to join us. Okay, good, you're there, okay. hi, Marissa.
Hi.
I'm so excited, and congratulations on your launch, which was last night, and now your second launch, which is tonight. So I'm going to read your bio, your wonderful bio, and then we'd love to hear an excerpt from Lucky. Marissa Stapley is the internationally best-selling author of 4 novels. The Last Resort was an instant Toronto Star bestseller, was shortlisted for the Arthur Ellis Best Crime Novel Award, and was optioned for television by CBS. Lucky was recently optioned for television by ABC Disney Studios. Marissa is also the author of holiday rom-coms under the pen name Maggie Knox. She has taught creative writing and editing at the University of Toronto and Centennial College, and founded the online writing school, The Starter, in 2020. Her journalism has appeared in newspapers and magazines across North America. She lives in Toronto with her family. Excellent. So you ready to read?
I'm ready. Thank you, Sam. I don't see myself. Do you see me?
I see you.
Oh, you see me. Okay, good. Good. Well, maybe it's better that I can't see myself. I am delighted to be doing my first reading from Lucky. I am reading from chapter 3, which is just when things start to get really kind of heated up for Lucky. As Lucky is a story about a con artist who finds herself alone and wanted by the FBI and on the run, and discovers she has a winning lottery ticket in her back pocket, which is not a spoiler. And this is the moment when she realizes that she is alone, but just before she realizes that the lottery ticket is a winner. Lucky stretched across the king-size bed and ran her hands over its silky sheets, searching for Carrie's warm skin. She lifted her chin and arched her back. "Morning, babe." No answer. She opened her eyes. She was alone in the bed. She caught her reflection in the mirror on the wall. Her hair was tangled and matted. Last night's mascara was making its way down her face. She didn't look like a person who belonged in a suite at the Bellagio. She looked like she'd crawled out of a dumpster. A wave of nausea hit. Way too much champagne last night. "Carrie?" Silence. They had set their phone alarms for 4 o'clock in the morning so they could be at the airport by 5, hadn't they? Lucky rubbed her forehead, then her eyes. When they'd returned to the hotel after their night out, there had been a man, there had been a man in the lobby, the same one who had been talking to Carrie at the bar in the casino. "Who is that?" Lucky had slurred. Had Carrie said something about the man being his new friend? If he had, in her champagne buzz state, nothing had seemed unusual about that. "Go upstairs," she hazily remembered him whispering in her ear. "Now, and only open the door if it's me. Get our bags ready to go, then close your eyes for a few minutes. I'll be back soon, I swear." She had passed out on the bed, expecting he would wake her when he came back up. Now, there was sunshine pouring through the crack between the curtains. The clock on the nightstand said it was 10:23. She was supposed to be on a plane right now. Where was he? "Hello?" She listened for the shower. Nothing. Maybe their flight was delayed. Maybe he was getting coffee and breakfast. She walked into the sitting room. His suitcase was still there beside hers by the door. She picked up her phone to try his number. His phone went straight to voicemail. Her stomach roiled again. What was in that champagne? Had Carrie? No, he wouldn't. Not Carrie, not to her. This was just a hangover. Eventually, she lifted herself from the cool marble floor. She tried his phone again, but it was still off. She turned on the television and switched it to the news channel so she could double check the time. 10:45 now. "David Ferguson and Elena Cadence," the newscaster was saying, using the names they had gone by in Idaho, "wanted for bilking dozens of senior citizens living in Boise out of savings and laundering money. They were posing as an accountant and a restaurateur and are suspected to have already moved large sums to overseas bank accounts before fleeing. Retirement funds have been emptied out, lives have been ruined, and now the police have announced there are suspected connections to organized crime." She turned. Her face was on the television. Carrie's face was there too. "Wanted for fraud, embezzlement, racketeering," the news banner below their faces read. Her panic rose as she listened to the newscaster speak. Video footage showed news vans outside their house in Boise. She stepped closer. Why were they talking so much about seniors? It was a lie. It had only been the affluent, not the elderly. That's what she and Carrie had agreed on. That was what her father had always taught her. Steal from the rich, give to the poor. Yes, fine, a little like Robin Hood. What was so bad about taking from people who had so much more than they needed? The anchor on screen kept talking, describing it all wrong. Lucky hadn't done those things, not racketeering. Carrie, what did you do? Lucky turned the television off. She walked to the safe and peered inside. He hadn't taken his passport, which meant he'd had another alias lined up, other forms of identification she'd never be able to guess. It meant he had been planning this for months, had never had any intention of escaping to Dominica with her, had always planned to leave her to atone for this all by herself. She sank onto the bed and put her face in her hands. She was just as bad as all the marks her father had told her to keep an eye out for over the years. The ones who are easy to scan because, if offered love or friendship or a good sob story, they willfully blinded themselves. They chose to trust. Blind trust makes the world go round, kid, her father would say. When it comes around to you, you grab that brass ring. Take what you can. Apparently, Carrie had been given that same advice, and she shouldn't have been as surprised as she was. Oh, Sam's muted.
I was completely muted. You didn't hear me complimenting you there. What I was saying is, sorry about that, is how much I love Lucky. I really love Lucky's character. I love Ambrosia too, and in such different ways. So with that being said, let's dive into the questions. Both Ambrosia and Lucky could be considered bad girls or unlikable female characters because they cross moral and ethical lines. So why do you think characters who push the envelope are so enticing to readers? And why do they spark such polarizing discussion amongst readers? Marissa, I'll start with you.
So I think, and we have talked about this, I talk about this idea so often with my author friends. And I think with Lucky, it's a little bit different because certain characters can be polarizing. They're morally ambiguous. You kind of are like, oh, this, what they're doing is so wrong. And I really shouldn't love them, but I do. With Lucky, I really wanted, I needed a criminal. I wanted a character who had a winning lottery ticket she couldn't cash because she was a criminal. But I really wanted her crimes to be something that we wouldn't hate ourselves for loving her. So in that passage I read, she talks about how she was raised by a con artist and he taught her to, you know, steal from the rich and give to the poor. And it was really important to me when creating Lucky, I started to think about like Ocean's 11 and 12, which I love to watch with my son, like how we got caught up recently watching Lupin, for example. I was watching a show called Hustlers as I was writing Lucky and trying to figure out different cons. It's a show about a team of con artists and they're like a family, but they only ever con people who deserve it. So they're committing crimes. It's wrong, but you're like, yes, yes, yes. Like, you know, I hope you win. And that's what I wanted to do. So it was a little bit different from perhaps other characters I've created where the moral ambiguity has caused you to question why you're rooting for this character. I think we just do root for con artists. And I think it's interesting that we do because the reality of being conned is really quite awful. I mean, it would be terrible to be bilked out of money, but then again, you know, maybe if you deserved it.
I think there's a sense of admiration too, because you have to be very, very smart.
Yeah.
Con someone. So the psychology of it is fascinating. Yeah. And I agree. I think Lucky is a good person who does bad things.
Right.
And maybe also she does them for almost a good reason. It's all very complicated, which I think is why these characters are also so fascinating. How about you, Laurie?
I don't know. For me, I find myself drawn to characters that feel realistic and relatable, even in their darkest impulses. So when I was writing Ambrosia, she's a person who does some horrible things in her college years. But what I wanted to do when I was writing her was to make her feel relatable even as she descended into darkness. So to make readers be able to see themselves in her, in some of her insecurities or her vulnerabilities as she's starting college. I think that's a very, you know, tender age for a lot of people living on their own for the first time, and this intense pressure to rebrand from who you were in high school and sort of shed that uncool version of yourself that I think a lot of people feel as they start college. It's this fresh slate and this pressure to align with the right people. And I think in Ambrosia's case, she really falls into that way too hard, and she ends up, you know, aligning herself with the absolute worst person who likes to play with other people and is kind of looking for somebody to who can try to keep up with her. And Ambrosia is looking for attention and validation, and she falls under this mean girl's spell. And I think that in itself is something that a lot of people can relate to, is getting caught up in that and maybe doing things that they might not have done otherwise because they're in with this new group of people, and it's sort of the price of admission. So when I was writing Ambrosia's character, I really wanted to play into all of those things that, you know, as horrible as her actions are later in the book, she, so that, you know, readers can see how it got to that point. She didn't just start out that way. She certainly didn't go in with these intentions that were malicious, but she went in wanting to be liked, wanting to be noticed, wanting to be seen. And, you know, a lot of her decisions and her choices come out of that intense need for attention and for validation. And that was sort of what I really played into when I was writing her, was just to make her insecurities relatable so that readers could see themselves in her, even as she has these very dark impulses.
Exactly. Well, she's very multifaceted, and that's her vulnerability, is that she fell prey to the wrong person, which I think for anybody would be difficult not to, because that person is very intoxicating. And that whole experience for her was very intoxicating. And I think you wrote it so well, as did you, Marissa, with Lucky, so, which is why I felt, you know, when you talk about sympathy, I did sympathize with both of these characters very much. Also, of course, questioned their actions and wanted, but what I found most important is that I wanted to follow their journeys. I was desperate to follow their journeys, which I think is what makes an excellent story. So discussing all of that with, you know, toxicity, both the characters have toxic relationships with another person, and both of them are involved with somebody they want to get away from at some point, someone who has a dangerous hold on them. They do want ultimately to remake themselves. They want to find redemption and forgiveness. Can you talk a bit about these relationships? So this would be with Lucky's father, with Carrie, and then with Sully. Laurie, I'll start with you.
Ambrosia's relationship with Sully is extremely toxic. She doesn't realize that though until so much later. And that's, I think, how a lot of us are with toxic relationships. You don't realize when you're in one because the hold is so strong. It's not until sometimes years later that you can look back objectively and realize that you were in a toxic relationship where you were being manipulated, you weren't acting like yourself. And I think that's something that a lot of people can relate to. And I think a lot of us have had a Sully in our life, whether it be a friend or a relationship or just somebody who had us in sort of a thrall and had us wanting to impress them. And that's what Ambrosia, she really wanted to impress Sully, and the lengths she goes to impress her and even shock her, because Sully just has this attitude, like nothing surprises her, nothing means that much to her. So that made Ambrosia made her want to be the person who means something to Sully and who can surprise her. And she gets in this pattern, and she can't really get out of it. And she's always climbing to try to find the next foothold. She can't just be comfortable in this friendship. But, you know, she sort of, at the time, she's so fixated on being Sully's best friend that she doesn't see for what it really is, which is, you know, peer pressure and a toxic friendship with, you know, a girl who's like the mean girl, queen bee, manipulating her into actions that she, you know, wouldn't have taken if she was friends with somebody else. And I think it really takes years past when they stop talking in college for her to really know, you know, the hold that Sully did have over her and to understand. And I think even when she's back at the reunion, she's just coming to terms with some of this. So it's interesting how these relationships can sort of, you know, evolve in your mind over time. So I wanted to explore that.
Well, I think it's all so interesting and also relatable, because if, you know, any of us, if anyone thinks of someone in their lives who has not been good for them, and no matter how old you get, you still think about them. You might Google them, you know, they still, in some way, there is a hold that you might be able to release yourself from as you get older, as you get further away from the relationship, but it probably never quite goes away. And I think you wrote about that extremely, extremely well. And it's what makes the story so intricate, are these relationships and emotions. And so, Marissa, the two characters I'm going to ask you about, so there's Lucky's father and then there's Carrie, because in some ways they're similar types of men.
So they are, they're very similar. And I often think about this idea of history repeating itself. And I think I've told this story before. My kids and I years ago watched Maleficent and she had her wings cut off. And it was a really big teachable moment where I said to the kids, now she's hurting people, because people who are hurt, they tend to hurt people in return. And people who have these relationships in their childhood tend to chase after those same relationships. So with Lucky, she was raised by this con artist father who we know from the first page picked her up off. She was abandoned on church steps. He picked her up like a lucky penny, carried her away, and told her through her whole life, basically it was a long con. He told her that she was his and she wasn't. So for Lucky, as the story progresses and she does eventually learn the truth about where she came from, although she doesn't know where she really came from, she can finally start to separate herself from the idea of Carrie, because ultimately Carrie is also gone in the opening pages. Like, we know she's not really John's daughter. We know she believes that. We know that Carrie has left her. We know that she can't believe he would do that, because she fights against it for so long, because it was also so hard for her to trust. And her father would say, like, you can't trust anybody but yourself, and you really hardly trust me. So for Lucky, it's about somehow, like, it's like flypaper. Like, she's stuck in these sticky, toxic relationships and she has to get out of them so that she can get away. And that's her journey. Like, her journey of redemption involves extricating herself from
that. And I think her as a child, when she's a child and you grow up with somebody who you love so much, because whoever's raising you, generally, no matter what the situation is, you love them so much. Mm-hmm. And there was a lot of that with Carrie too, as you said, because finally she learns to trust someone again, and she loves him. And so it's also, both of these books, for being such suspenseful books, are also extremely layered. And there are a lot of messages and a lot of discussion that can be had around these kinds of relationships and around emotions and around strength and vulnerability. I recommend, if anyone who's watching, if you have not bought these books, you have to buy these books. I'm telling you, I read a ton, and I these were both fantastic. I'm gonna get a little personal. So I read interviews and pieces that you've both written about the inspiration for both of these books. Marissa, I'm going to start with you first. I know this may be a little hard to talk about, but you're extremely open about it. I know that you wrote Lucky and a very difficult time in your life. So if you'd like to tell us just a bit about that.
I'm having a good day. I feel like with grief. So what happened was my mom, who I'm very close to, got sick and passed away. And actually, when I found out she was sick, I was writing a different novel. And I suddenly, it was gone. Like, it just swam away like a fish in the ocean. It was gone. I would open my computer and it wasn't there, and it was too dark, and somebody had died, and I just couldn't get it back. And so Lucky came to me like a beautiful gift. I heard a radio report about an unclaimed lottery ticket, speculation that the person was wanted by police, kind of noodled that around for not very long. And then one day was heading on a bus to visit my mom, and Lucky, it was almost like she sat down beside me and was like, here I am, this is who I am. And I am resilient, and I am a lone wolf. I'm one character, because all of my other novels have been multi POV and complicated. And she was like, I stand alone. You'll be able to keep me straight no matter what happens. I texted my agent. She was like, amazing. You should do it. Got to my mom's house. And it was so much fun for us to talk about. So even though I was in this really dark place, this story really carried me through. The idea of it carried my mom through. She was able to read it. And to this day, it sustains me. And my mom would ask me to keep working on it, and if I was going to come over to see my visits as writing retreats. And she was kind of relentless. Like, sometimes I was like, I don't know, I can't, like, I'm sad. I don't want to. And she'd be like, I can't sleep unless I can hear you typing. So that's where it came from. And it really, but it's not a sad book. It's very fun. It's hopeful. It's, So that's where it came from. And I think it's an example of stories saving us, saved my mom and I from sadness. And this is a character I really do believe can do anything, can even distract us from the fact that, you know, I know this is a COVID free zone, but there's a pandemic.
Things no. are terrible.
But if you
oh read my like, God, when did that happen? I think first I met your mom at your book launches. And she was such a beautiful soul. Like, she just radiated light, as do you. And this book, yes, it is not a sad book. Sad things happen, as they always do. But Lucky is a very inspiring, empowering character. That you were able to do that is a testament to your own strength, through your mom's force or not. And what you accomplished from that is quite incredible. And I will get back to a little bit later, checking my watch, the other very exciting accomplishments that you have going on with this amazing book. So Laurie, you are a former model, which I find very glamorous and exciting. You were referred to in the Toronto Star, I think, as a early Angelina Jolie. Was that the... was that the comment? And I think it was spot on, absolutely. So how did that career filter in to The Girls Are Also Nice Here?
You know, I think it definitely does filter in. Like, my modeling experience was largely very positive. And I loved the other girls that I got to know. I didn't have any like horrible stories about toxic people or anything like that. But that said, no matter how well you get along with people, there's always that element of competition, especially in a field like modeling, where you're literally competing against your model friends for the same jobs a lot of the time. So of course, there's going to be jealousy a little bit, even if you keep it to yourself, even if you're happy for your friends, it's natural that it's going to be there. Yeah. And I think the fact that, you know, there is that element of competition, it kind of stuck with me. And well, my modeling days feel like a different glamorous lifestyle now, especially since I wear sweatpants every day right now and barely put on makeup. But I think that always stuck with me, and I have always been inspired to have that element in my books. It also comes into play in my YA books. It's just the element of women and girls being pitted against each other by society, and the ways that we're supposed to uphold these standards. So not only do we have our own expectations for ourselves, but we have this whole societal expectation crashing down on us all the time that we're expected to fulfill, and it's impossible. And I think a lot of women sort of resent it and rebel against it. And somebody like Ambrosia, who's she's fresh off a an incident in high school where her boyfriend cheated on her and she had trusted him. And that sort of jaded her to the world. And all of a sudden she's, you know, a little bit bitter toward other girls. And she sort of had that seed of resentment in her when she started at Wesleyan. And so she met Sully at the absolute worst time because she's looking for somebody to pay attention to her and to validate her and to love her. And Sully's looking for somebody who to play with, essentially. So I really wanted, and Sully sort of plays with Ambrosia's tendencies to compare herself to other people and plays on that and knows her vulnerabilities. And this book is really about, you know, the lengths women will go to when they want the same thing. And I don't want to give any spoilers away as to
what. I know it's so hard, right?
But there's a lot, I think, to be said about the way society does, you know, have women again, pit women against each other in so many little ways, so many ways, basically every day that I knew that was going to be a big thing in my book. And it definitely is something that came from my modeling experiences and friendships and, you know, being in a profession where you spend all your time with these other girls, you're living in a foreign country together, but somebody else might get a job and you might not, or you might get a job and somebody else might not, and sort of how to live with that jealousy and that element of competition. So definitely, you know, was in my mind as I was writing this.
So interesting, because it feels like such a different world from the writing community. You know, now you're in, and have been for years, the YA community, I don't know it very well. I know that the female writing community, the thriller writing community, the Canadian writing community, and you know, everyone we know all over the world is such a supportive, warm, generous, kind, safe place where there's such a great deal of support, such a great deal of love and celebration for each other. And of course, you know, someone gets something really amazing. Of course, we want that for ourselves, but it takes nothing, like it doesn't take anything away from our happiness for somebody else. It inspires hope and possibility for us all. So it's just so interesting that, you know, the modeling world, as compared for me at least to the female writing community. I don't know if you wanted to say anything about that. I don't know if you feel the same way.
No, the writing community is literally the best ever. And like, I'm so glad I'm part of it because the people are amazing. And I don't know what I would do without, you know, writer friends. They're just the best. Like, and it's true though, there's room for everyone. There's no, like, that's how I feel. Like our books are different. Like there's room for everybody on the shelf. So if somebody else does, you know, something happens for somebody else, it doesn't take anything away from something that would happen to you. It's not like we're competing as much as we're supporting, which is great. And like, I don't know. I'm always like just as happy when something great happens for one of my friends as I am if it happens to me. I'm like jumping around the house with glee. So it's, I just love the whole community. It's wonderful.
I agree, which brings me to my next question, but I have to say I get as excited about seeing my book on a shelf somewhere as I do about seeing everyone else's book. So Marissa, the last time I went to a bookstore, your book wasn't there yet, but I will still walk past windows, so I will be able to see it and do a squeal in Toronto. But I did see it at Shoppers, Laurie. I did see your book at Shoppers. And so I was like, oh, it's my friend's book. So there is definitely an element of excitement for each other. You two have already had so much happen with these books, with other books. But is there anything exciting that you would like to share more about? Things that I spoke about in your bios, perhaps? Marissa, I will start with you because something very exciting just happened, or at least was just announced.
My book is in bookstores. My husband always says that's all that matters. So I was recently able to announce the the Disney ABC. I don't even know if it's ABC Disney Studios or Disney ABC Studios. It's kind of like Penguin Random House potentially to be. Anyway, it was optioned back in the summer, and I was just able to announce that option. And mm-hmm. The Last Resort was also optioned. So these options do happen, but the exciting thing about this is that there's a producer attached, and his name is Carlton Cuse, and he is the co-mind behind Lost, Jack Ryan, Bates Motel, Lock and Key, Colony, and is an enthusiastic mentor of aspiring screenwriters. So I have been dreaming of learning to screenwrite for some time, and it really seems like such an incredibly lucky break that the producer who optioned Lucky has generously offered basically to mentor me to get to a place where I can be the one to write the pilot should the show get off the ground. There's still so many things that need to happen.
Right, there's so many steps and everything.
So many steps, but Carlton, he's very busy. So half the time we have a Zoom call and it gets moved like 50 times or he's not there. But he was in Toronto shooting Lock and Key in December, and I couldn't do anything normal with him because of you know what. So I offered to take him for a walk in High Park, which is where near where I live. Aww. And we had a great walk in High Park, and it was so lovely. And I bought him a CBC t-shirt, and I was the biggest geek you've ever met. And he really liked it because it turns out he's actually just a regular guy and super geeky also. So it's made the whole process has been a huge amount of work. I still don't know exactly where it will go, but my exciting news is I went for a walk in Hyde Park with Carlton Cuse. So.
I think also the exciting news is that you are screenwriting, which is something that's incredible. So give yourself all the credit that you deserve for that. That's wonderful. And yes, everything in publishing, everything in screen and film and TV, it is all step by step.
No, and I will say now that we're talking about this, when we're talking about Carrie and the toxic relationship, Carlton has a real thing for Carrie. And a lot of our conversations have been about what he calls the Carrie of it all. And he doesn't want Carrie to be as bad as he is. So should the show make it to the screen, what he really wants is something more sort of the way we were-ish. Like it's kind of, and it's a really interesting thing to be doing with a book that's already published. And every time we talk, I'd be like, no, Carrie is bad. And now I'm like, okay, I get it. Carrie is redeemable. So it's interesting anyway.
And film and TV, it can be so different. Mm-hmm. You know, they always say that, the movie was so different than the book because mm-hmm. it's such a different medium. It's such a different way of presenting an idea. It's such a different way of presenting a story. Anyway, I just think this is all amazing. Please keep us up to date. Laurie, what about you? Tell us something. You're an instant bestseller. That's super exciting.
Yeah, that's been amazing. It's been 4 weeks now on the Toronto Star List. So that's so surreal and incredible. And I'm really happy that it's the Shoppers book lovers pick of the month for April, which is great. And hopefully people can still buy it in Shoppers.
Yes. Yeah, they still can. Grocery store, not to talk about the unmentionable, but yes, Shoppers. It should, yes, I think. I'll check for you if you want.
Awesome. And the my TV option was with AMC. There's been a little bit of updates, but I'm not able to share them, which is a frustrating thing about publishing. From being in publishing, some secrets that you have to keep for so long. But I will say that I'm an executive producer, so that was cool.
Fabulous.
Whole thing when it was optioned. So I'm really excited. I'm obsessed with AMC. Breaking Bad's my favorite show. So the fact that they wanted to make my book is into a series is like a totally surreal moment because just obsessed with all the shows they put out. So
and there's so much that's book to screen right now. I think these would make really, really amazing either series or I think they're both for television, I think you said at this point. So to see them on television and they've just done wonderful, wonderful things on all these networks now. So I will be hounding you for information on that. And if you can't tell me, just say it's like Fight Club. All right. I'm going to ask one more quick question before I go into the Q&A, which is heating up over there, I can see. What is one thing that would surprise people about you? Laurie.
Oh, geez. My fear is people dressed like rabbits. That's a really weird fear. Like adults dressed like the Easter Bunny, they just give me the creeps so badly. And I know it's really weird, but like just makes me shiver and it's terrifying. Those pictures of people like with the giant Easter bunnies and like, all their kids.
It is creepy.
It is super creepy. So that's something that really freaks me out that most people probably wouldn't expect from me, but yeah, dislike Easter bunnies.
So is there any specific reason the Easter bunny or bunnies in general, or are real like soft fluffy bunnies okay?
Yes, and like little kids in bunny costumes are really cute. I don't know, it's just like the adults, I don't know what it is. I don't know why it's like just gives me the creep so badly. I don't know if like there was some something in my childhood that I don't know about, like a bunny like that I saw that freaked me out. I don't know, but anyway, it still persists to this day.
Right, well, I love that. And I just want to make a quick note that Sheila said that your book, yes, Shoppers, she saw it at Shoppers, so everybody can go to Shoppers. And Marissa, I imagine yours,
it's there too. Somebody sent me a picture today too.
Today I was a little... okay,
heartened by the fact, I didn't know if you were still allowed to buy books in Shoppers, but great news.
I think
right.
It's an essential item. So Marissa, what about you? The last thing we're talking about. Something that would surprise.
I'm also afraid of adults dressed as bunnies. Just kidding, but I honestly think I am now. I've never thought about it, but as you were talking, I was like, God, that's actually really terrifying. It's even worse than clowns. Somebody asked me this the other day, I think on a podcast, and I was like, nothing. I'm such an open book. Like I just tell everybody everything. But something that does surprise people about me, I think, is that I don't drive. I don't have my driver's license. I am not a driver. So when Lucky going everywhere by bus, like that I could really get down with that. Like I know what that's like to be trying to catch buses and being on buses and trains and that kind of thing. So I'm not a driver. I don't know why. I don't think I used to be. I think I had boyfriends, some toxic boyfriends perhaps, who drove around in my small hometown in their IROCs and gave me rides. And I moved to the city, took this
subway. I forgot about those.
Was always on the subway, met my husband fairly young and his car was standard and I just couldn't figure that out. And then we got married and then I got pregnant and yada, yada, yada. Now I don't drive and I'm afraid of it now because I'm an old dog basically. So I would love to just suddenly get my license and surprise everyone, but I'm just not sure. I was thinking maybe my son, who's 14, he's just a few years away from getting his license and like he could drive me everywhere. That would be fine, right?
So I have this image of you now and there's a bunny in it, sorry. I have this image, you are driving and you've gotten your license and you're in LA and you're driving on the whatever big popular road is there and you know your hair is flowing in the breeze and then there's a giant bunny beside you in the passenger seat.
I thought you were gonna say I hit him with my
no, although that's an even better idea. Because we're of course all diabolical authors. I'm gonna move over to the chat because I think there are definitely some questions here. So I'm gonna go to the Q&A. And all right. So these questions, Carolyn, these questions are fantastic. Some of them we did talk about. So you obviously had the same thoughts I did because yes, with, you know, likable and unlikable characters, female characters, I think people really, we love talking about it. It's such a discussion to talk about what, you know, makes a character sympathetic or unsympathetic.
Sorry, was that Carolyn Howard?
Yes, favorite. Carolyn Howard. Yeah, she's amazing. Carolyn,
you're always so good for a question, Carolyn.
Yes, she is, and she's so supportive. Totally unrelated to the book talk from Carolyn. I need to know where Laurie got that fantastic don't overthink pillow.
Oh, yes, my pillow. You know what? I got that at a furniture store. I think it was Tepperman's here in London when we moved into this house a few years ago. and we were looking at new bed sets, and I saw that pillow, and I knew that I had to have it. My busy author mind needed that pillow for a reminder that not to get too in my head. So
it's, totally,
it lives in my
mind. What's the name of the place? I'm gonna order one too.
I think it was Tepperman's. I think. Tepperman's.
Thank you. All right, Tepperman's. Yeah, I think we could all use that pillow. Marissa, this is from Sarah. Who would you like to play Lucky in the adaptation?
So I always imagined Lucky would be, I imagined her as Shailene Woodley while I was writing, but we talk about her sometimes now. Carlton and some of his team really like the idea of Zoe Kravitz, and they talked about that at the beginning when we were first chatting about her. And I think that's a really interesting idea. So that would be cool. I would watch her read a grocery list. So
definitely. And Big Little Lies. Did you see Big Little Lies?
Yeah.
She plays that sweet spot between fierce and vulnerable. Mm-hmm. That is so important to get in a character. And that is an excellent choice. And a great question. Suzanne wants to know, Laurie, did you know a Sully when you went to university? And if so, is that where you got the idea for your books? We talked a little about modeling, but did you know a Sully?
No, first of all, hi, Suzanne. That's my sister-in-law. She's the best. She comes to like every event and she's just wonderful. And she's with my niece. So hi, Avery, too. I did not know a Sully in college, thankfully. I think for me, though, there's always those cool girls. And I was never one of them. So I think I was able to sort of write Ambrosia from not based on my own life at all, because I wasn't ever in a friendship like that with somebody. However, I think I wrote a lot of her vulnerabilities and insecurities out of a place I had myself, because again, I was never one of those cool girls, and I never even knew how to become one. Like I always had my friends, but I was totally not in that group. And I never really cared to be either, but I think there's always, you know, a part of, like, I can still think back to being in high school and feeling really insecure and being, right, you know, feeling like everyone was so much cooler than me. And, you know, I just, you know, analyzing everything I said and did and like hoping I didn't make a faux pas. So I think I channeled a lot of Ambrosia's fears and insecurities and vulnerabilities from her in that college freshman year timeline. I think we can all look back on teen years and still remember some of those things so vividly. And I sort of channeled some of that here.
And I think that's definitely what makes it, again, so relatable and feel so real and feel so real. Just right when you read, I read the whole book, but when you read that opening scene, I think we were all right there. Marissa, this is also from Carolyn. You comp Lucky to the flight attendant. This is from someone who's trying to query, she says. Was this a comp from the novel by Chris Bajalian? Great, great novel, great series. Or was this a change after the HBO series came out? The process of figuring out comps always feels difficult for querying writers.
Well, and Carolyn, we have talked about this in class, and I think it's really important for all aspiring writers at some point. You don't need to have it at the beginning, but you should have a comp. And I know it's great to think like this has never been done before, but ultimately publishers are always looking for a way to market and sell something. So if you can comp it to The Girls Are Also Nice Here, that's a great idea, because better yet if it's a successful novel or a show. But the funny thing is, I only noticed like maybe 3 weeks ago the Google Books description went up, and I didn't comp it to The Flight Attendant. I guess this was a marketing thing, and I hadn't seen The Flight Attendant or read The Flight Attendant, so I was like, oh my god, I have to watch this. And I had a couple of days where I wasn't feeling very well, so I was able to just be in bed, and I binged The Flight Attendant, and I absolutely loved it. It was very inspiring for the TV writing, but this was something that kind of came out of left field for me. It was a comp that I hadn't even thought of. So it was a kind of lucky surprise that one popped in there.
I love how you, the word lucky now every time, right? Yeah, it's so good. I have to say, Simon Schuster Canada has the most incredible marketing and publicity team. Incredible. So flight attendants, and then, you know, everything around Lucky. And then Laurie, there was a lipstick. Like there was, you know, a signature lipstick for good. The girls are all so nice here. Anyway, just thank goodness for marketing and publicity. Another really interesting question. And this is from Anonymous. At what points did you know or discover the endings of your novel? This actually might have to be the last question. So at what points did you know or discover the endings of your novel?
For me, I don't plot. So I discovered it as I was writing. I think that ending just came onto the page as I was typing it, and it felt right away, which was great. And you know, even through revisions, it stayed largely the same. So I knew it was the right way to end this book and felt strongly about that. And I'm glad that it came into my head. So
it's a great ending.
Thank you.
That's all I'm gonna say. Marissa, how about you?
I had initially envisioned, because I had this screenwriting dream. So when I came up with Lucky, I was like, this is a TV show. I'm going to write a TV show. I don't know how, but I'm doing it. So I was trying to develop it into a TV show initially. So I really wanted the ending to be somewhat open-ended in a way that, like, she was heading off into her future. I don't think I'm giving anything away here. Like, you knew you wanted more and everything was somewhat resolved, but it could be like season one. So I didn't exactly know how I was going to do that. Well, it became fairly clear. I just really want to be careful not to totally ruin the whole ending. It is hard, but yeah, I think it just, I wanted it to be like a really good ending to the first season of a TV show where you still would be hungry to know what happened to her next. So that's something I knew.
And I think in all books, even with a resolution, with the books I read and the books I write, I feel there's still a hunger for what comes next. Which is exciting because it makes you continue to think about the book or about a second season. Mm-hmm. Okay, there actually is one last question. I'm going to answer it on behalf of these authors, and if they disagree with me, they are welcome to pipe in. I just want to double check the name. Yes, Marnie Webb asked us writing.
That's my sister-in-law, sorry.
Oh, isn't you? You have the best families. None of my families came.
Hi, Marnie.
All right. Well, Marnie, does writing energize or exhaust you? And I will answer. And I think I'm going to say both for all of us. I would say both. Is that correct? That it's exhilarating and terrifying. It's exhausting and energizing. Is that, yes? Would you like to add one last thing about that?
I think both. I do. It really depends. I mean, Marnie, I guess we'd have to ask Joe, my husband. But I think he would probably say it exhausts me when I am really, really into something, and I'll just go for it until the energy runs out. So it's like I'm sorry to bring up bunnies, but like the Energizer bunny, right?
The bunny is the new pandemic. We're so good at not talking about that for the most part. That was bunnies.
Yeah, but then it's like whole, it's entirely exhausting after that, right? Like you're energized and then it like, you're like roadkill after that. So that's how I feel about it.
Yeah, no, it's that's spot on. Absolutely. Absolutely. And Laurie, is there any that you want to add? Or
I have three kids, three and under. I'm always tired. I think I drink a lot of coffee. But that said, yeah, the combination of both. I feel like if I don't write for a while, like I just don't feel like myself. So I need that. It does give me a spark and give me creative energy. But then, yeah, at the end of the day, I'm absolutely exhausted. So yeah.
I think, and especially now because of the unmentionable. And Laurie, and three kids under three. I actually think that there is either a clone sitting here, or there is a clone asleep in bed right now. Thank you so, so much to the audience. for coming tonight. I know people have gone to many, many Zoom events. And so we'd really, really do appreciate your support to, you know, continue to show up, to celebrate these amazing book launches. I am so happy, Laurie and Marissa, for both of you. These are spectacular books, and I'm so excited to see them soar and to see the TV series that will come from them, because I know they will. And of course, to Simon Schuster Canada, to Rita and Jillian, thank you. And to Kitchener Public Library and Sheila Bauman. It's our home away from home, and we miss your snacks very, very much. But thank you so much for continuing to support us and to continuing to invite us.
Thank you, Samantha. Thank you, Laurie and Marissa, for visiting us tonight and sharing some insights into your books without spoilers, since they're new and many of us are still wanting to dive into them. We look forward to your next novels, more exciting news as your books turn into TV or movies, and we wish you all much success. And I'm extending an open invitation for you to return in person to our theater when it's safe to gather in groups again. We will do it all. We will have signature drinks and snacks and book signings. And as always, we'll connect our readers with fabulous writers like each of you. Thanks, and a shout out goes as well to independent bookstore Wordsworth Books. They have been supporting all of our 85 Queen online events, and we appreciate their presence in our community. They are offering a 20% discount on tonight's two books. So if you haven't already purchased your copy, I invite you to visit Wordsworth Books online for your personal and your gift-giving purchases. And to tonight's audience, with the weather warming up, a fabulous evening sunsets, and another challenging home stretch, I know that online events take a different kind of energy and commitment. So I and the library thank each of you for choosing to spend some of your evening with us. And as we do with all of our 85 Queen events, we will be posting tonight's chat on the library's YouTube channel. So we invite you to share it. Please watch social media and our website for details for more author talks, including an upcoming visit in May with Genevieve Graham, returning with her latest book, along with Janet Skeeslian Charles. They'll be in conversation with Kaylee Platts. Registration is now open for that. Again, thanks to each of you for being here tonight. Have a fabulous weekend, stay safe, and we'll see you soon. Good night.